In sports science, we spend a lot of time and energy focused on the hamstring muscle groups and the hip and groin area. In fact, we've already talked about testing both of those regions in this athlete testing series so far. But are we overlooking a really crucial muscle group? The calf complex is critical for producing and transmitting forces through the lower limbs to the rest of the body or to the ground. In fact, in this video, I'm going to show you just how much contribution to vertical and horizontal force comes from the calf complex. So given its role for transmitting these forces, which are critical for running and sprinting and jumping and changing direction, it's worth considering how we can measure and track strength in this muscle group. And that's going to be the focus of this video. My name is Joe Clubb. I'm a sports science consultant for Global Performance Insights, which helps teams, practitioners, and organizations all around the world gain insights from their sports science. Now, before we start discussing the test options for measuring calf strength, I actually want to recap some of the anatomy of the region, because I just feel like it's not as well known as with the hamstring and the hip and groin, as we discussed earlier in this series. So we're focused on the posterior compartment of the lower limb, and we have a deep compartment and a superficial compartment. The deep posterior compartment is made up of flexor hallucis longus, the tibialis posterior, the flexor digitorum longus, and the popliteus muscles. Whereas the superficial compartment is made up of the gastrocnemius, the soleus, and plantaris. We're going to focus today on the gastrocnemius and the soleus. And taken together, these two muscles form what is sometimes referred to as the triceps serrae. Now, these muscles are tasked with plantar flexing the foot. But because the gastrocnemius is a biarticular muscle which crosses the knee joint, the gastroc is also involved in knee flexion. And distally, both these muscles attach into the Achilles tendon, the thickest and strongest tendon in the body. So as I've already mentioned, the calf muscle plays a critical role in running and sprinting and jumping and cutting, all these really crucial movement demands for team sport athletes. But let's just look at a couple of studies that highlight just how important they are. So this study from Tim Dawn and his colleagues at University of Melbourne highlight that high muscle force is required of the soleus across a number of different running speeds. In this study, they collected experimental gait data on 9 subjects running at 4 different speeds. In this table, we can see a whole host of numbers and the different gait metrics that were collected, which include the peak forces developed by the muscles and the peak muscle contribution to vertical ground force. Now, across all running speeds, soleus, gastrocnemius, and the vastus muscle group provided roughly 75% of the total vertical force impulse needed to accelerate the body upward, with soleus alone contributing as much as 50%. And for speeds up to 7 meters per second, the increases in vertical ground reaction force with the increasing speed were due almost entirely to the action of the soleus. Here we can see those peak forces broken down by both muscle and speed. And yes, while we talk a lot about how the hamstrings have such a high contribution to force at the higher speed, we can also see that soleus here is having a notable contribution to the forces across all of the speeds. And we have a similar story in this study by Hamner and Delft. So they looked at slightly slower speeds, only up to 5 meters per second, but they were looking at the contribution of the different muscle groups to both vertical and horizontal acceleration. They showed that the soleus was the largest contributor to upward mass center acceleration, so vertical acceleration, with a peak contribution at 5 meters per second that was as much as 77% of total vertical acceleration, so peak upward acceleration. And this large upward mass center acceleration from soleus came from the fact that the muscle force produced a large vertical ground reaction force of approximately 2 body weights. Now, keep that figure in mind, 2 times body weight for later. And we can also see that gastrocnemius also contributed substantially to this upward acceleration. And the second part of this figure then is looking at braking and propulsion. So now we're considering the horizontal forces. And during the propulsion phase, gastrocnemius and soleus were the largest contributors to forward mass center acceleration. So here, soleus to forward mass center acceleration increased by 1.4 meters per second squared across running speeds. And for gastrocnemius, which still had as much as 35% of the contribution at 5 meters per second to peak forward acceleration, that also itself increased by around 0.7 meters per second squared across the speeds. So some really strong evidence there just how important the calf complex is to running. And therefore, the forces that we were talking about there, the contributions, the actual peak forces involved, clearly involves a great deal of strength to be able to produce, transmit that level of force. So it's certainly in our interest to include strength testing of the calf complex within our testing battery with our athletes. And yes, very commonly used is an endurance test for calf raises, and is a relatively simple and accessible test that absolutely I would recommend. But of course, this is more endurance focused. In certain sporting environments, we're obviously lucky to have more advanced technology. So I want to look then at the options we have available to try and objectively measure strength through the calf. I'm going to demonstrate three different options for measuring calf strength using different tools available from Valve Performance. So first off, we could use a handheld dynamometer to try and assess strength in the calves. And in this case with Vald, we have their Dynamo option. So we could set up an ankle plantar flexion test with the participant in a supine straight leg position. And here we're just going to have the subject push as hard as they can against the pad of the dynamometer for 3 or 4 seconds before being instructed to relax. Now, as we've discussed before in the hip and groin video, handheld dynamometers have the benefit of making testing perhaps more accessible, certainly more portable, but we have to be aware of the reliability both between testers and within testers. That limitation can be somewhat overcome by using a fixed frame dynamometer. So for instance, like Vald's ForceFrame. With this technology, again, we can test ankle plantar flexion to get the strength of the calf muscle group. And we can do this in either a supine or a seated position. A really critical piece of information when thinking about calf strength and calf function is that research has shown that there's a difference in the contribution between gastrocnemius and soleus depending on your position. So at 90 degrees, at a bent knee position, the contribution comes more from soleus, whereas with a straight leg, 180 degrees, the contribution is actually higher from the gastrocnemius. And this is why it's important to certainly strengthen and rehab in both these straight leg and bent leg positions. Ideally, with our testing, then we would test both these positions to try and capture the function of the muscle groups in those differing positions. I did, though, find one paper that found a correlation between these two as high as 0.7. If you are limited by time, which is very often our limiting factor in testing athletes, and you can only pick one position, it's not the end of the world. They are highly correlated. But if you do have perhaps athletes with injury history in this area, or athletes who then go on to get injured and you're doing testing through rehab, those individual cases may be when you try to test in both positions. So we can see in the seated position then using the force frame that we have the top of the knee raised against the pad of the dynamometer and the heel slightly off the ground. As you contract the calf, there is going to be some natural raising of the heel there. This should be an isometric test, but we do see that movement with the contraction there. So just keeping an eye that the force is not becoming too much movement at the ankle. So the athletes are instructed to push down with their toes, thereby pushing their knee into the pad for the required time, usually 3 to 5 seconds. And again, allow a relaxation rest period in between reps of at least 30 seconds. Similarly, then with the supine position, they're going to have their toes in this case resting on the dynamometer pad. And again, the instruction is still then to push down with their toes. My personal preference for trying to test the calf muscle groups is to use force plate, although, of course, I appreciate not everyone has access to that kind of technology. And we can use a seated position with the force plates underneath. So either with some sort of custom rig with a weighted barbell on top. Horse plates can also be used to test in a more of a straight leg position. So the Warnecke paper I mentioned earlier that investigated the correlation between isometric maximum strength in the calf muscle in the bent and the extended knee joint position use these two methods. So for that straight leg position, a leg press machine with force plates embedded onto them was used to better isolate the force produced to the calf complex. If we could do a bilateral test or a single limb test, although of course, if you are testing with bilateral force plates, you can take a look into the differences in the left and right force in the bilateral position. So some things to look out for on this test, again, like I mentioned earlier, you want to make sure that there's not too much movement. This should be an isometric test of the ankle plantar flexors. And so we really want to keep an eye that the heel is just not lifting too much. With this test, we get outputs very similar to our other isometric tests, particularly similar to our isometric mid-thigh pull. So if you haven't already watched that video, I definitely recommend checking that out after this one. Our outputs are our absolute force measures, our relative force, if we want to account for body weight, which we're going to talk a bit more about, as well as our left to right asymmetries. Look at rate of force development. As I talked about in the isometric mid-thigh pull test, if you are interested in rate of force development, then you need to instruct the athlete to contract as hard and as fast as possible to be able to assess that. There can be issues with the reliability of RFD. So I think, again, it's something you should plan beforehand because it determines what cues you use. If you are not sure and you're not convinced that that's going to be worthwhile or reliable enough data, then perhaps it's worth avoiding that cue and just having the athlete build into it consistently. Again, I talk more about that decision in the isometric mid-thigh pull video. Now, I am a fan of making force relative to body weight, making it the equivalent of body weight. So you can say how many times body weight that the athlete was producing. Here we have an example of some data that Phil Glasgow shared on an Aspartar video, which I'll pop a link to in the corner so you can watch Phil talk on this topic in much more detail because he is extremely knowledgeable in this area. And this is data from Irish rugby national men's team looking at their seated calf testing relative to body weight. So each point along the x-axis represents a different athlete. Obviously, this has been anonymized. And along the y-axis, we have this force relative to body weight figure. And interestingly, you see here that really the average is around about 1.5. But Hill mentions that the target for across their squad actually is 2. And that is linked to what we mentioned earlier with that 2 times body weight being produced by the soleus. Then each athlete has 2 different dots, one representing their left side and one in the more blue color representing their right side. So we also get an overview of the difference in asymmetry for each athlete. So we're really fortunate there to see some really high level data shared publicly. So thank you to Phil. So I think I've touched on the strengths of this kind of testing kind of throughout the video, because clearly there is a need to try and capture the calf muscle group strength in our athletes to be able to test and track and then also track in rehabilitation. The technology you have available is going to determine the testing that you can do in your own setting. If we think about perhaps some of the weaknesses or the limitations of this test, it's interesting because throughout this series, I've often talked about how the test may be somewhat limited because it's an isometric test that we're trying to then relate to very dynamic action. Really interesting with the calf muscles. Research shows us that these work quasi-isometrically, that the muscle length is not changing too much throughout movement. In fact, it's more being determined by the length of the tendon. So then if there is a muscle group that is perhaps arguably most relevant for isometric testing as well as isometric training, perhaps it is these calf muscles that work in this quasi-isometric nature during running. And as I've talked about throughout this series, these kinds of isometric exercises are becoming more and more common in athletes' programs. So if it's something that they are doing routinely as part of either their prehab or their strength program, then perhaps it makes it even easier for us to capture and track data. Thank you for watching this video. If you found it useful, please hit subscribe so you don't miss out on the next athlete testing video coming up in collaboration with Valve Performance.